The next wave of leaders in industrial manufacturing will build an ecosystem that capitalizes on the promise of analytics and connectivity to maximize efficiency for themselves and their customers. They will map out their strategies and prioritize measures that will bring the most value to their business, starting now with pilot projects, and building greater strengths in data analytics with cross-functional teams of experts.
Orientalists, like many other 19th century thinkers, conceive of humanity either in large collective terms or in abstract generalities. Orientalists are neither interested in nor capable of discussing individuals; instead, artificial entities predominate. Similarly, the age-old distinction between Europe and Asia or Occident and Orient erodes beneath very wide labels every possible variety of human plurality, reducing it in the process to one or two terminal collective realities.
So that creates tensions, and that's what I want to talk about. Because I think it's important that we are, as a society, able to have an informed debate about how much privacy is enough but not too much, how much security is enough but not too much. Privacy, as a human right, that's simply quoting the Universal Declaration. In the physical world, we've got all kinds of protections. There is evidence that we care about our privacy. We've got locks, we've got obscured glass, we've got lots, we wear clothes, we put up shutters. And technology continues to erode the privacy that exists in the real world, in the three spatial dimensions. Security cameras, automatic number, plate recognition take away anonymity. Long lenses, paparazzi, take away distance and the privacy that used to create. And body scanners are increasingly being used to see through, for example. This process isn't going to slow down, and the new quantum technologies are actually being able to do gravitational sensing. And that's advancing at a remarkable rate. And you can't shield gravity. So some of the new quantum technologies are able already to see through walls. And there are technologies also for seeing round corners now using scattered light from lasers. Technology continues to erode privacy.
What's the literal definition of risk? Business schools use risk analysis. So, what do you mean by risk, and we need a dictionary? When you look at dictionary, this is literal definition of risk. What it says is, the definition, for example, the possibility of injury, a dangerous element or factor, chance of, degree or possibility of such loss, and so on. So, risk has two parts, as you look at the literal definition of risk. One part is the consequence of some kind of particular danger, hazard loss. And the other is about the probability of it, chance and consequence, okay? And then at least just as English language concerns, when you look up the word of safe and safety, which you learn as, it's a little bit of a loop, a little circular argument that free from harm or risks, secure from danger, harm or loss, the condition of being safe and so on for all. And why we take out of it. At least when we talk about safe, at least in English language, we are talking absolute something is safe, or it sounds safe.
Language death is not mainstream theater. It is not mainstream anything. Can you imagine Hollywood taking it on? It is so far outside the mindsets of most people that they have difficulty appreciating what the crisis is all about, because they are not used to thinking more about language as an issue in itself. Somehow we need to change these mindsets. We need to get people thinking about language more explicitly, more intimately, more enthusiastically. Interest in language is certainly there. In the general population, most people are fascinated by such topics as where words come from, or what the origin of their town's name is, or whether their baby's name means anything. They are certainly prepared to play Scrabble and a host of other language games ad infinitum, and language games are often found on radio and television too, but a willingness to focus that interest on general issues, a preparedness to take on board the emotion and drama inherent in the situation of language endangerment, is not something that happens much.
There can now be no reasonable, science-based doubt about the reality of global climate change effects brought on by the cumulative and rapidly growing emission of so-called greenhouse gases, primarily carbon dioxide, into the atmosphere. As these effects become increasingly more obvious worldwide, so commercial interests, groups of concerned individuals, and national governments have been gripped by what amounts to mass panic about what to do about it. To many, Paul Ehrlich's Malthusian population bomb of 1968 appears about to explode in the world's face in an indirect version of his millenarian vision of population growth, which outpaces agricultural production capacity with predictably catastrophic results for humanity. And his three-part crisis scenario does indeed seem now to be present. A rapid rate of change, a limit of some sort, and delays in perceiving that limit. Ehrlich's work was roundly criticized at the time, and later, from many quarters, and much of what he predicted did not come about. Nevertheless, can the world afford to take the risk that the climate scientists have got it wrong? Is it not in everyone's interests to apply the precautionary principle in attempting to avoid the worst of their predictions now, rather than at some future time? As the chairman of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, Mr. Rajendra Pachauri, has recently pointed out, 11 of the warmest years since instrumental records began have occurred in the past 12, while major precipitation changes are taking place on a global scale.
In my view, it's impossible to talk about wildlife and not think about its role in livelihood. And I guess part of that is my own view, part of the research that I do in Africa. In most Eastern West Africa, I look a role, all the humans rely on wildlife as the source of food and also the source of income. And we talk about our wildlife, it seems we talk about fish, we are talking about what probably the single most important source of protein for human that across the globe. And so billions of, or more than a billion of people rely on fish as their primary source of animal protein, and most of these people living in poverty. So the management of fish resource of wildlife in that sense causing incredibly important to livelihoods and health. And also, wildlife tourism is the multiple billion dollar industry, and in many places, such as Africa, South America, it can be the 0.1 source of income, it can be the 0.1 source of foreign income for economies.